You are listening to Megiddo Radio. Megiddo Radio is a radio ministry of Megiddo Films. For more, visit our website at www.megiddofilms.org.
Good evening, everybody. Welcome. This is Paul Flynn with Megiddo Radio for the 31st of May, 2014. Thank you all for tuning in. On this week's show, we're going to continue from the last show, which was dealing with Pope Francis's comments. And I wanted to take it a little bit further. As we discussed in the last show, many of the Pope's anti-capitalist, what some would say Marxist, I would disagree. I would think it more in line with Mussolini described as fascism, the merger of corporation and state, to which Rome, when she gets preferential treatment, largely because in some countries like the United States, where they try to pit communism against capitalism and come up with this middle road of really what is private, public-private kind of partnerships, which is really what fascism was, a state-controlled economy. And it can seem very, very nice from the outside, but that is what it is. Pure communism very much is the complete owning of everything by the state. Now, they'll call it all different things. They'll call it common ownership. They'll call it the workers own everything, all these kind of nice, quaint ways of describing things, but at the end of the day, it is really the state who will own everything, and the state will dominate everything in communism. Fascism, you have private property being allowed in certain circumstances, but it is being subservient. It is underneath the quote-unquote rights or of the people, or what is called a common good. What we looked at the last time was Pope Francis made a comment about he wanted a legitimate, quote-unquote, legitimate redistribution of the wealth by the state. His own words to the United Nations on May the 9th, 2009, last. The thing is, how far back does this go? Now, on today's show, I want to look at a document, a papal encyclical that was written in 1891 by Pope Leo XIII. And I also want to look at a Catholic video, Roman Catholic video. This is done by Roman Catholics teaching about social justice. Now, you've heard, anybody's been around evangelicalism these days, people like Timothy Keller, influential people like that, this idea of social justice has come in to the church, an idea completely foreign to scripture. It is completely pagan. And it is based on covetousness. And this whole idea coming from, been taught in modern times by the Jesuits, people like Luigi Taparelli, which is what the, and this is a Roman Catholic, Roman Catholics acknowledge this. This is that social justice comes from the Jesuits, Taparelli, the Jesuit, and he got it from Thomas Aquinas, the 13th century theologian, who is the main doctor of the Roman Catholic Church. Much of his writings, much of his understandings are still carried on, and Rome is incredibly consistent in how much it follows the thinking of Aquinas. Now, there may have been at different points various lullings or fading away of the philosophy of Aquinas. But it, many of the sources I've read, that it had a renewing past the 1870s, when Rome lost its political power, and then Rome was in turmoil. It was no longer political power. A brief period of time, from 1866, 1870, depending on the time you really go with, from the time when the Kingdom of Austria said that recognized the Kingdom of Italy, the Papal States knew that their time was over, and it was the beginning of the end, 1866. That was when Pio Nono, the Pope Pius IX, was Pope at the time. Actually, for one point in time, he had to escape down to Naples. It was very much, I don't think people realize it now, because very much the deadly wound is healed in Rome, and she is now a nation state again with Vatican City, which is the agreement with Benito Mussolini in the 1920s. And through various concordats, Rome has reestablished her as being a controlling, mighty influence in the world. Now, to put Rerum Novarum, the document, which is looks at the working classes, Rerum Novarum in Latin, it depends on the source you look at, means of revolutionary things or of new things. Now, I'm not a Latin scholar, so I've gone with a number of the written definitions of what Rerum Novarum means. Now, Rerum Novarum, written in 1891, Pope Leo XIII wrote this as Rome is in turmoil. She establishes Vatican I in 1870 to establish Ultramontanism. Ultramontanism is a doctrine of complete centralization, papal infallibility of the Pope being all in all. That was reduced a little bit, window dressing really, from Vatican II onwards. There was, in Vatican I, for example, there was some people who completely opposed it, even within the Roman Catholic Church. So this is a church now that is in this turmoil and is now commenting on, in an environment where Karl Marx is been out of, at least a decade, more than a decade, Das Kapital, the Communist Manifesto. In Rerum Novarum, Pope Leo XIII, in really, and like a lot of them, the different popes, to position themselves with, especially the proletariat or the working classes, as they write in the encyclical, that they want to reestablish themselves politically, strategically, to get themselves back in power because they are weak at this point. They do the papal states are gone. It's the Kingdom of Italy, and in a way, the Pope is almost like a prisoner. Almost not to be feeling sorry for that Antichrist, that man of sin who exalts himself, 2 Thessalonians 2:4, above all that is called God. That little horn described in Daniel chapter 7. But just to give you an idea, this is 1891, and Pope Leo XIII writes, and he's also, interestingly enough, at least from the Roman Catholic sources I found, he was taught by Luigi Taparelli himself, the Jesuit, who coined the term himself of social justice. Now, this social justice is highly tied in with the idea of the social gospel. See, the idea is, it's not fair that person, say there's a person who has half as much as you. And again, it varies. There's different theories of social justice. But the idea, well, the living wage, John Augustus Ryan, a Roman Catholic thinker in the early 1900s, early 20th century, wrote the book A Living Wage, this whole idea that you should be paid according to as you need, according to your need. That whole idea of need is really important. That it comes from Aquinas, Thomas Aquinas. It's written about extensively in Rerum Novarum. And it is deeply behind the ideas of St. Timothy Keller. And Timothy Keller acknowledges that he reads a lot of Counter-Reformation materials. Timothy Keller was a highly influential evangelical, trained in Westminster Theological Seminary. He's got a Presbyterian church in New York City. And he's highly influential. Part of Gospel Coalition, etc. and also Trinity Divinity Evangelical School, if I'm not mistaken. And the social gospel, the social justice, is coined by the Jesuits, dated back to Thomas Aquinas. Thomas Aquinas, to my knowledge, never called it social justice, but the ideas are there. So these, and Thomas Aquinas himself being influenced highly by the pagan philosopher Aristotle. And if you take Aristotle's ideas, Aquinas' ideas, and I don't want to go too much into Aquinas today, because Aquinas I want to deal with in another show, Lord willing, next week, and show how his ideas influence fascism, corporatism, or crony capitalism, another different title you could use for it. I've got lots of quotations from his Summa Theologica and other works that he's done. But Lord willing, I'll get into that next week. Rerum Novarum. Now, this document, if you will read a lot of Roman Catholic sources, at least the Roman Catholic sources that I've read, or even people, they're not even being necessarily critical of Rome, but when they're commenting on Rerum Novarum, this papal encyclical from 1891, written by Pope Leo XIII, trained under Taparelli, he talks, most people will say, well, it, and people read it in different ways. If they're very much capitalist leaning, they'll say, well, Leo XIII defended private property rights. Now, it's very important to understand the private property rights. If you don't understand the whole idea of private property, and basically, thou shalt not steal, you own what you own, that thou shalt not covet your neighbor's goods, your neighbor's wife, your neighbor's ox, etc. The 10th commandment. So that it isn't common ownership of all goods. See, the thing is, if it's unjust, you see, if it's common ownership of all goods and somebody has very little, probably maybe due to their own choices or whatever, or maybe their business went out of business or whatever, but that is seen then, well, because it's uneven, that is unjust, according to an Aquinas Jesuit, a very much Leo XIII, or Catholic social teaching, it's also called, that would be seen as unjust. It's seen as, from a moral standpoint, the common ownership of all goods, which is, cannot change. It's part of what Aquinas called the natural law. Well, private property was part of the positive law. Now, positive law could change. It was part of it. Positive law had to do with human customs, traditions, things that were done for the benefit of human society, but could be subject to change if the common good dictated that that was necessary. Basically, subservient to the common good. The idea of the common good and the common ownership of all goods and the common destination of all goods, the term used by Pope John Paul II, all these different terms feed different forms of collectivism. Collectivism such as communism, liberation theology, fascism in Germany and Italy, socialist feudalism, pre-Reformation. And what you had during the Reformation in the 16th century, you had a growth and a, I wouldn't say a complete burst, but of capitalism, private property. And that saw the economies of the West, or those countries that had the gospel, that were by the grace of God, by the change of their hearts towards God, then believing and trusting, or believing in private property rights, then those, and hard work as well, because slothfulness is condemned in the Bible, those economies, the Protestant economies, thrived. While if you look at Roman Catholic economies, historically Ireland, Italy, Spain, Mexico, South America, on and so forth, poverty. That has been the overwhelming characteristic of those countries. Whereas if you look at Protestant countries, that has changed recently because a lot of them have adopted collectivism. The right, for example, the right to free healthcare, the right to education. This is all part of collectivism. If you have the right to health care, the state must intervene and provide you with that health care. But do we have a right to free health care? Where does it say that in the scriptures or anything like that? You eat your own bread. If you do not work, you shall not eat. There's no idea of the necessity of the state to have to prop up people who make bad choices. Now, there's obviously people who will quote-unquote fall through the cracks, but there's always been charities there. There's always been people donating. And a lot of the time, those who are genuinely poor, but in Western societies, I mean, I don't think we understand what poor means. Poor in most of the world is living on less than a dollar a day. That's properly poor. But social justice activists, coming from Roman Catholic teaching, this is unjust. We must redistribute the wealth in order, and the way that looks in reality is a taxing of the most productive part of the economy and giving it to the poor. In theory, but that never happens. In theory, that would be bad enough if that happened. The unproductive going to the productive going to the unproductive. This redistribution of wealth, de-incentivizing, making hard work not rewarding whatsoever. Taxing it all off, and so we'll work up to 30, 40 hours, and it'll get past that time, and we might as well take the rest of it off, because the government's going to tax us anyway, and going to take 40 to 80% of it, depending on what, so why bother? I mean, overtime is useless at that point. So it de-incentivizes hard work. It incentivizes those who are not so inclined to go look for work. Generally, the welfare state, people on social welfare, things like this. And these ideas are coming from documents like Rerum Novarum. And I don't want to say Rerum Novarum is the only document that they get this from. Very much Thomas Aquinas, and you go back far enough, even Aristotle. But listen to what some people have said about Rerum Novarum before we start digging into Rerum Novarum. I'm just trying to get this quotation here. Marxist turned Roman Catholic Eugene Genovese, right? He writes this. Now, he writes this in 1997 in his book Secularism in the General Crisis of Capitalism. So he is a Marxist turned Roman Catholic, writes about Rerum Novarum. He says, the Marxists were right. The 20th century has been a century of the general crisis of capitalism. Even if they erred badly in the nature of the crisis, that crisis, which had been primarily a crisis of the spirit engendered by the loss of faith in God and a transcendent law, still the Marxist critique of capitalism had much in common with the critique offered in Rerum Novarum. So it had much in common with the critique offered in Rerum Novarum, much as did the critique offered by the organic conservatives of 19th century Europe by the southern slaveholders in our own country. Austrian economist, I won't read that. Another comment I'm going to read, just on the influence, the modern influence and the importance of Rerum Novarum. We have here John the 23rd, who was recently canonized and made a quote-unquote saint by the Roman Catholic Church, states in Mater et Magistra, wrote, by far the most notable evidence of this social teaching, he's referring to Rerum Novarum, an action which the church has set forth through the centuries, undoubtedly is the very distinguished encyclical letter Rerum Novarum, issued 70 years ago. So this is John the 23rd, who presided over Vatican II. He also says the norms and recommendations contained therein were so numerous, so momentous, that the memory will never fall into oblivion. High praise indeed. Pius XI, in encyclical celebrating the 40th anniversary of Rerum Novarum, wrote, With regard to the civil power, Leo XIII boldly passed beyond the restrictions imposed by liberalism. And again, thinking back to that time, they were highly opposed to what is called liberalism. What they call liberalism, and I often lumped it in with Protestantism. Actually, if you talk to some Sedeventists, they'll be very, very similar to this. And they will try and weed out any idea of liberalism or unbelief in Catholic dogma, especially. But they will see liberalism and Protestantism as almost the one to be destroyed. With regard to the civil power, Leo XIII boldly passed beyond the restrictions imposed by liberalism and fearlessly proclaimed the doctrine that the civil power is more than the mere guardian of law and order. It's more than that. As opposed to what the Bible says, that the state is to wield a sword, but that is in cases of, say, somebody kills somebody, the state should execute that somebody. The Genesis 9:6, the death penalty should still be carried out by the state. It is true indeed, Pius XI says, it's true indeed that a just freedom of action should be left to individual citizens and families. So, he just says that one comment, right? It is true indeed that the just freedom of action should be left to individual citizens and families. Quote that, you'll say, well, he's a capitalist, so you have freedom to choose your own actions, it's not controlled by the state, etc. But, and here's the but this principle is only valid as long as the common good is secure and no justice is entailed. It's Pius XI, and there's various others. What I'm quoting from here is an excellent book covering the economic and political thought of the Roman Catholic Church, written by John W. Robbins. And if you are looking at the Megiddo TV version of this show, I'm just showing the book in front of you all. It's called Ecclesiastical Megalomania. Ecclesiastical Megalomania. To understand a lot of this, and I've been poring over this for the last couple of years, I read this book, I think about 3 years ago, and I bought a lot of the references. Aquinas, I've read all of Rerum Novarum. It's lengthy enough, Rerum Novarum. It's about 19 pages on a PDF here that I have in front of me on my iPad. But this really goes through, if you really want, like, almost like, let's say, a textbook on it. Unfortunately, John W. Robbins isn't around anymore, otherwise I would happily get him on the show for an interview. But he passed away back in 2008. But he was a Christian man, ran a group called the Trinity Foundation. The Trinity Foundation still continues. And this book, really, I highly recommend it. It really helps to understand a lot of Catholic social teaching and its inevitable conclusions. Now, let's look with that in mind. So, it's been established the Rerum Novarum is still an incredibly important document to Pius XI. Pius XI, right, just before Pius XII, the Pius XII, who was basically Hitler's pope during the Second World War. You had John XXIII, incredibly influential. These ideas permeate throughout. Rerum Novarum is still quoted if you go on Catholic social teaching. Rerum Novarum is still seen as a hugely important encyclical letter. So let's see what it actually says. And we'll look at some of the things. Often when people argue about this, capitalist-leaning Roman Catholics, who very much would be actually themselves opposed to collectivism, socialism, communism, fascism, they would kind of be maybe even self-described libertarians, kind of Mises-leaning libertarians with the economic views of people like Friedrich Hayek and Mises himself. And that kind of, it's usually called Austrian economics. Very, very similar to biblical economics, but the only thing is it doesn't base itself on the idea of, I think a lot of the people who are in Austrian economics believe Mises and Hayek were both atheists, if I'm not mistaken. not based on the Bible and thus saith the Lord and axioms like that, axioms, first principles by which they derive their the truths of which their economic theory goes forth, but they very similar. And I think it was Mises at one point leaned towards that. Now, in Rerum Novarum, private prop. So for the capitalist, the libertarian-leaning Roman Catholic who looks at Rerum Novarum, and often people will be quite aware of the significance of this if they're aware of Catholic social teaching at all, that it defends capitalism. And I'm going to look at the passages that somebody could look at and say, well, this defends capitalism. Rome is now defending capitalism and freedom in the West. You just have to ignore the history in surrounding that period as well. For example, in Rerum Novarum, paragraph 4 and 6. 4 and 6, I just get it now. I'm going to be jumping around a lot. And you can get this on the internet. You can just type in Rerum Novarum PDF. You don't have to pay for it or anything like that. A person could look at the following, especially the beginning of the document, and just cherry pick certain quotations, such as the following, to say that he's defending private property. To remedy these wrongs, Leo XIII said, the socialists working on the poor man's envy of the rich are striving to do away with private property, and the content and contend that individual possessions should become the common property of all. So this is what the socialists are saying. To be administered by the state or by municipal bodies, they hold that by thus transferring property from private individuals to the community, the present mischievous state of things will be set to right. So he's presenting the socialist view of things. Inasmuch as each citizen will then get his fair share of whatever there is to enjoy, but their contentions are so clearly powerless to end the controversy that were they carried into effect, the working man himself would be among the first to suffer. So you read that and you think, well, he's obviously for private property. They are, he says, moreover emphatically unjust, for they would rob the lawful possessor. So this seems, just from this paragraph alone, that he's defending private property. Distort the functions of the state and create utter confusion in the community. This is why I don't agree with people. It is collectivist. This document is collectivist. I don't agree with people who say this is pure Marxism. The language is very similar at times. Talking about class warfare, class struggle, very similar to Marx. But it is not pure communism. It's got similarities, as all forms of collectivism do with each other, whether it be liberation theology, whether it be communism, socialism, fascism, guild, feudalism in the Middle Ages, whatever form it takes, they've got similarities, but there are differences. Paragraph 6 in the same document, it says, what is of far greater moment, however, is the fact that the remedy they possess is manifestly against justice. Still talk about the socialists. For every man has by nature the right to possess property as his own. We won't read any more than that. He talks, uses very similar language to Thomas Aquinas later on, the full perfection of the animal being. Man is a social animal. And is very much, I'd have to go into Aquinas' view of law the next show. But in order to understand the way Rome argue. Now, so from paragraphs 4 and 6 and a few other places as well, they're not the only places, it would seem Rome is defending capitalism, the very central tenet of capitalism, private property. What you own is your own. The government cannot steal from you through taxation or anything else in order to give to somebody else. Well, they usually don't give to somebody else, but in theory, it's even wrong, but it doesn't even work. And if you look at the private property is not to be destroyed. He says, paragraph 22, paragraph 38, and paragraph 46 of this document, Rerum Novarum. So he argues that, and this is still seen as hugely important. When I was playing last week, the Huffington Post, in their kind of newsroom thing that they have going there, they had a Catholic blogger on who mentioned that what Francis was saying about the legitimate redistribution of the wealth, and he's blatant anti-capitalism, they loved it because they were very much, the Huffington Post is incredibly liberal. And, but he, the Catholic blogger said, well, this goes back to Rerum Novarum. He mentioned it during that blog or that, how would I put it, kind of a Skype call that was coming in. And you can look at that show if you're a bit confused about that. I go into things in more detail. Now, so in some parts, it argues that private property must be defended. So far, it seems like capitalism. Now, let's look. Socialism rejected in paragraphs 14 and 15. Again, I'm not going to quote the entire document because it's at least about 19 pages. But there is government intervention called for to protect. Let's look at paragraphs 14 and 15. 14 and 15. The contention then that civil government should, as its option, intrude into and exercise intimate control over the family and the household is a great and pernicious error. So again, he's continuing on this argument. They shouldn't intervene. Rome always seems to argue one way or the other. State should not intervene. Goes on to say, true, if a family finds itself in exceeding distress, utterly deprived of the counsel of friends, and without any prospect of extricating itself, it is right, morally right, that's what he's saying, it is right that extreme necessity be met by public aid, state aid. This is where the state intervention comes in. And this has been seen right across the Western world. This has been seen in the healthcare. If you look in Britain, in the NHS, or you look in Ireland, it's completely public. There's little semblances of... And often what the scary thing is, what they'll do is they'll make all the healthcare public. And then some regime will come in and privatize it all and sell it off. And then you have a virtual monopoly to everyone, whoever buys it. Rather than a level playing field. And you end up with this kind of the government, through intervention in the economy, picking the winners and the losers in the economy. That is fascist. That is a controlled economy. That is what Benito Mussolini called corporatism. The merger of corporation and state. Again, they're working together. Whereas the only time the state should get involved is when there's a contract been breached. When, again, there's murder or there's theft or something like that. So it says, since each family is part of the commonwealth, in like manner, if within the precincts of the household, there occur grave disturbance of mutual rights. So their mutual rights are not being met. And again, who will define the rights? European Union, the United Nations saying rights like every person has the right to work. Sounds wonderful. And it sounds like, well, we shouldn't be prevented from working and enjoying the fruits of our labor. Something like that. But what it really means is the state must intervene in order to either force an employer to hire somebody. Nobody should ever be forced to hire somebody. If you're a business owner and you don't want to hire somebody for whatever reason, you're not obliged to, by the state at least, to hire that person. For example, just say you're a business owner and just say you're a Christian and you love the Word of God and just say somebody comes before you and maybe they're living a licentious lifestyle or they're a homosexual or something like that. But they say, oh, you're being discriminatory against the homosexual or the person who's drinking every night. You're being discriminating against that person. So the state intervenes, forces maybe even forces the employer to hire 20%, 10% homosexuals. A similar version is seen in, say, the shipping industry in the European Union, for example. Will argue for equality of the sexes, even in fishing, which is an incredibly difficult job. I mean, out in ships and boats, and talks of, I can't remember the exact numbers, I think it was like 30-40% of women, to have quotas of, you'd have to hire a certain amount of women. What happens when the state intervenes and says, well, we have to have a certain amount of homosexuals, we have to have a certain amount of people from this lifestyle, in case they would be discriminated against? This is how it's usually argued. And it's really just an excuse for more and more power by the state. Now, between you and God, just say you're a business owner and you don't hire somebody for something that's sinful, and really you just don't hire them because they might just say they're a really godly Christian, but you may be, you don't want to be brought under conviction because that person is living well, then that would be wrong. But we can't police people's thoughts. We can't get inside someone's head. The state cannot do that. Now, he says, if the disturbance of mutual rights, see, if you can give out all these rights, the more rights you have in a society, the less liberty there is. Because it means the more things that the government are promising to provide, the more the government has to intervene. And that is where you get fascism. It is not where the state owns everything. There is some private property, but again, the state is picking the winners and losers. This is what often is called a free market economy. That's not the free market. That is corporatism, crony capitalism, if you want to call it, or even fascism, as Mussolini called it. So in paragraph 14 of Rerum Novarum, he says public authority should intervene to force each party. See, this is where it says, well, you can have your private property, but here, the public authority should intervene to force each party to yield to the other its proper due. You've enough money there. You've too much money. We're going to tax you more in order that this person can have more. Basically, that is against the teaching of Scripture. It is collectivism because, again, it calls for more government intervention. More government intervenes in the economy. It's controlling these public-private partnerships. It sounds wonderful. It sounds very nice. But really, that's the whole idea behind it. This third way, as Tony Blair, Bill Clinton will call it. He goes on to say that, for this is not to deprive citizens of their rights. Again, who would deprive them of their rights? It sounds very pious. But the thing about it is a call for more government intervention. If you say, everyone has the right to free education. Why? Why does everybody have to have the same opportunities? Or the same amount of money? Or however you define social justice. We deserve, in the grand scheme of eternity, we deserve nothing but death and hell. We are born radically depraved and God-hating. We don't deserve anything. So if we're talking about justice, we don't want justice. And often, the people don't realize what they're looking for. And they make these carnal interpretations of the Scriptures when the Scriptures talk about the poor and the needy. When the Bible says, blessed are the poor in heart, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Okay, so Leo XIII says, for this is not to deprive citizens of their rights, but justly and properly to safeguard and strengthen them. Again, who gets to determine what the rights are? But the rulers, and usually what they do to try to break up the family, is they call children's rights. The right of the child, protection of the child, again, gives the state more excuse to intervene. He also says, but the rulers of the Commonwealth must go further. Here nature bids them stop. Parental authority can neither be abolished nor absorbed by the state, but it has some source of human itself. I'll skip on a little bit. He condemns, quotes here, later, Thomas Aquinas, the child belongs to the father. It is, as St. Thomas Aquinas says, before it attains to the use of free will, under the power and charge of its parents. And again, it is a private property, or it is a private, how to put it, just underneath the common good, all underneath the collective. There's private property when it suits the society. Chapter 16, it also talks about intervention as well. We approach the subject with confidence that in the exercise of the rights which manifestly appertain to us, for no practical solution of this question will be found apart from the intervention of religion and of the Church of Rome. That was seen deeply and horrendously and horrifically during the mid-90s in the Rwandan crisis. Rome picked sides. Rome went against the communists because... Notice this one, friends. If you study Rome and the political activities with the Ustasi regime in Croatia, they favor fascism above all else. But if they cannot get their fascism in, or fascist dictatorship in, that will favor them, they would prefer communism to capitalism. Capitalism is enemy number one. They don't necessarily want complete state ownership. For example, in the United States, where they would have had some semblances of free market capitalism for quite a long time, or quite a lot of it in the 1800s, really died out in 1913 with the Federal Reserve, the central banking institution. You can look at different movies on the internet, I think a lot of that cover the fact that the Federal Reserve in the United States is a central bank, but it is not federal, it is not governmental, it's a private institution, and it doesn't have any reserves. It doesn't have any money. It prints money out of thin air in order to buy government bonds to be paid back with interest. That's the way the central banking system works. It is money created out of thin air. That is the kind of institution that they created in 1913. It talks about, skipping on a little bit later, the church improves and betters the condition of the working man by endeavoring to further, in the most practical way, the interests of the working classes, and considers that from this purpose recourse should be had in due measure and degree to the intervention of the law and of state authority. So you can have your private property if people's rights aren't being tarnished or not being distributed properly. But how do you define what is need? And again, it goes back to all the way back to Thomas Aquinas, who talked about each according to his need. Need dictates how who determines need. It's really the state and or the religion of the land, Rome, as she... This is really for a manipulation of power play. This is papal power at work. And she has been remarkably, over the centuries, consistent, varying in different ways. Rome is a chameleon and will act in different ways in different countries. But she's remarkably consistent with the teachings a lot of the time of Thomas Aquinas. So government intervention is called for to protect in paragraphs 14 and 15, natural law and the law of justice according to Rome. And this is another part I really want to look at. This show is going to take probably a little bit longer. Some of the Marxist language is seen in paragraph 42 in class struggle. And then I want to look at the controlled economy in paragraph 44 and 45. So the natural law and the law of justice, verse or paragraph, I keep saying verse 32, paragraph 32 and 34. So, 32 and 34, and we'll just look at a little bit of that, but you can read all the 32 to 34, I think, is the real important part. It talks about, by the state we here understand, not the practical form of government prevailing in this or that nation, but the state as rightly apprehended, as it is to say, any government conformable but its institutions to right reason and natural law. Using very similar language to Thomas Aquinas. Thomas Aquinas had four. His understanding of law was like this: natural law, positive law, divine law, and the eternal law. The eternal law, for example, rocks fall. The divine providence is another way of saying it, but he called it the eternal law. Really, the eternal law is the divine law, as summarized in the Ten Commandments. The divine law, the Ten Commandments, he called this. The natural law, how rational creatures would interact with the eternal law or God's providence. So, for example, he would have seen a natural law could not change. Common ownership of all goods, Aquinas would have seen it. We'll look at some of the quotations next week, Lord willing. He would have seen that. The common ownership of all these goods between all people as being part of the natural law. But then the positive law, which is human customs, inventions of human societies, in order for the betterment of human societies, and they are allowed. There's nothing wrong with the positive law, but the natural law is, the positive law is subservient to the natural law. And this is what Rome means by the natural law. And I'll just return to the encyclical because I don't want to spend a lot of time on Aquinas here, but a lot of this goes back to Aquinas. And to those dictates of the divine wisdom which we have expounded on the encyclical on the Christian constitution of the state. I just want to skip on a little bit. Okay. Halfway through paragraph 33, and we'll just look at this section for this part, but I would encourage you to read the encyclical itself, highlight it, and realize the parts it defends private property, and then in other parts it says it is subservient to the rights of men, very, very piously, in the same way that you'll hear groups saying things like, there's a group in Ireland called People Before Profit, property rights are not more important than human rights, things like that, slogans like that. Communists have similar slogans that keep propping up here and there. Leo XIII says, it would be irrational to neglect one portion of the citizens in favor of another. And therefore, the public administration must duly and solicitously provide for the welfare and comfort of the working classes. This is a fancy way of saying redistribute the wealth. He says, otherwise, that law of justice would be violated, which ordains that each man should have his due, or what's due to him, what he needs. To cite the words of Thomas Aquinas, as the part of the whole, we are in a certain sense identical, so that which brings to the whole, in a sense, belongs to the part. What belongs to the whole belongs to the part. Among the many, Leo goes on to state, among the many engraved duties of rulers, who would do their best for the people, the first and chief is to act with strict justice. Notice how this, the social justice, the social gospel, there's nothing wrong with doing things for the poor. There's nothing wrong with feeding people generally starving, generally all that. There's nothing wrong with that from a private individual to do that, or even for, I think it's more individuals in the church. The church as an organization should be taking care of the orphans and widows and people within their church, and then provide individuals, I believe, within the church should provide for freely of their own volition give food or whatever else to people who are generally poor. But in the West, people aren't generally, often in the West, if you go through Dublin, for example, and you give somebody €5, often that will be used for drugs, that will be used for drinking. They are often, it's not people who are generally looking for food. I mean, if you go to certain countries, if you go to parts of Africa, if you go to parts of Asia, parts of South America, you'll see genuine poverty. But where they're often calling for the redistribution of state and all this kind of thing, they have much more than people had throughout human history. And that's what we're calling poverty. That's what we're calling need. So, the strict justice, okay, he says, the first and chief is to act with strict justice. This is justice. And who administers justice? The state. The state wields the sword. The state is the one to administer justice for the death penalty, all these kind of things, for breaking of the law, etc. The church is not supposed to wield the sword, and the church is not to do different things like that. But Rome is a church and a state at the same time. Strict justice, with a justice which is called distributive, towards each and every class alike. Redistribution of the wealth is another way of saying that. Another part in paragraph 34, he says, indeed, the cooperation is in respect so important that it may be truly said that it is only by labor of working men that states grow rich. So his argument is, well, it's only by the hard work of these men, all men, you know, if it wasn't for that, well, that's how you grow rich. Very Marxist kind of argument. Justice, therefore, demands that the interests of the working classes should be carefully watched over by the administration, the government. Again, he says all these things need to be consistent, paragraph 34, with the common good. The common good. No one left behind. Everybody getting free, demands free education. Everybody should get this. Everybody should get that. Where's the stop? And the thing about it is, these things don't really work anyway. They're highly inefficient. They cost a lot of money. They don't provide the services. Healthcare ensures everybody's on waiting lists. Whereas, allow people to provide and get the government out of it. I mean, for example, if you had private healthcare, if you had properly a good hospital, for example, but just say, but what if that is not regulated by the government? Well, just say they kill somebody. Well, manslaughter charges and murder charges exist. That's when the government should intervene. Or doing something that's incredibly dangerous and will cause harm. But if they're running their business, see, the thing is, we've got to trust individuals have to be responsible for their choices. And this is a biblical idea. But the thing is, the young people in the church today, those who are listening, Timothy Keller, all these other guys, they don't want to be responsible for their own choices. So the collective needs to take the blame. And everybody, the stronger, need to redistribute to the weaker, etc. And I am not against grace and people in the church helping each other out, but justice does not demand that, or does not demand that the government intervenes. One last thing that I want to look at before looking at this video, that is looking at Catholic teaching, social justice. And this video, found online on YouTube, it's from, I couldn't find the longer video, it's called For the Others, and if anybody knows a Catholic social teaching video called For the Others, please send it on to me, or even the DVD, or wherever it comes from. I really want to look more into it. So, this whole idea of social justice, we go through it, and then, I won't have time here, a controlled economy, maybe just quote one or two places, a controlled economy, and this is what fascism is. Controlled economy, paragraphs 44 and 45. I know I'm going in really strong detail, but I want to show that this document is not supporting capitalism. Some people, some zealous writers will claim that. And it is not calling for out-and-out socialism. It is calling for fascism. It is calling for a controlled economy. '44 and '45, it talks about, for example, in '45, I'll just give you a few, one or two examples before we leave it here. Let the working man and the employer make free agreements, and in particular, let them agree freely as to wages. Sounds so good so far. Nevertheless, there underlies a dictate of natural justice, again, this idea of social justice, the natural law, things like that, more imperious, ancient man, that any bargain between man and man, namely that wages ought not to be insufficient. The idea of the living wage. This comes from John Augustus Ryan. Not just him, but he wrote a book called The Living Wage. Influenced Franklin Delano Roosevelt, his New Deal, New Society, the welfare state. During Franklin Delano Roosevelt, the government, I think, tripled in the United States. The social security system, people in the country became, how would I call it, collateral on the debt. America, I think in the early 30s to mid 30s, became pretty much bankrupt because of the Federal Reserve. Now, that bankruptcy continues with, I don't know, 14, 15, 16, 17 trillion owed to the private Federal Reserve. But that this, how do you determine whether wages are sufficient? You bring in things like minimum wage. You're controlling, again, the economy. Whereas what would happen in a capitalist economy, just say one place pays very little. Well, they're going to have a high turnover of staff, number one. People aren't going to stay there very long. And they're going to go somewhere where the wages are paid much, much higher. You're going to go there. But the employer is not under any obligation. He's only under obligation to offer you a wage. You can accept or reject it. And if it's not good enough, go somewhere else. Start a business yourself. Things like that. But instead, well, the government needs to intervene. It needs to up the minimum wage, even though the minimum wage drives up costs across the board, even gets people fired. For example, maybe a business isn't making enough money to pay people 10 euros an hour. But just say the minimum wage goes up to 10.50. They're going to have to fire maybe 30% of their staff. That happens a lot. You know, when they up the minimum wage and it sounds wonderful, let's give, as Obama said, the president of the United States one time said, let's give America a raise. But the thing is, it's almost like saying, let's have the lower classes get fired. And I also want to show you with this, pragmatically, it doesn't work. Most importantly, it's anti-biblical. It encourages covetousness, coveting of other people's things. Yeah, you're right, you know, he's too much of that. I should have some of that. Allow me to, you know, I can't find a job. I should be able to sponge off the welfare system for about a year or two. And that de-incentivizes somebody to go out and get work. Because it's much easier to sit on the dole and earn, in Ireland, I think it's like 170, 180 euro a week, than work slavishly, as it might seem to some people, and come out with maybe 350, 400 euro a week. Because, one, you're exhausted, and you've no free time, and you're only earning about 350 a week. It's not that much more, according to some people's minds, and might as well stay on the dole. If you can survive off that, and then can go have fun, have most of your free time, it's appealing. See, pragmatically, it doesn't work. But it's not biblical at all. Again, it encourages covetousness and theft. Taking from the productive part and going away from that principle. It's at the end of 2 Thessalonians, which it talks about that you eat your own bread, that you're not busybodies. That if a man does not work, he shall not eat. Okay. I want to look at a video before we finish up. This video is on YouTube. It's called Rerum Novarum Catholic Social Teaching, and I just want to briefly comment on it and play a lot of it for you guys on this show. And I just want to double check that everything is still recording. Yes.
So everything we do should be in sync with that.
Again, just to point out there, this is available, and I just saw this now, and I've watched this video a number of times. Available from Adult Spirituality Department at Ignatius Prep, it might be a prep school or something like that, in San Francisco. So, I have said all these things. Now what do Roman Catholic Jesuit theologians, etc., teach about it? Now, this is coming from Roman Catholics themselves.
And so everything we do should be in sync with that labor.
Scripture uses the word poverty or poor over 2,000 times. On a strictly mathematical weight, which is a more fundamental message of the good book? I also firmly believe in a God who hears the cry of the poor. Abraham Heschel said that the prophet is the one who perceives the silent sigh. The prophet is the one who can hear the voice of those that nobody else pays attention to. You know, our tradition going back is...
So just for those who are listening to the radio edition on the Podomatic site, this man who's talking is Chad Evans, teacher of religious studies at St. Ignatius Prep, San Francisco, California. So...
As far as it's been written down... And what's written down is what was passed down orally, as far back as we have stories, is about a God who cares for the one who nobody else cares for.
And just, I'm going to take one of the verses that talks about, okay, Psalm 34, 34 verse 6. The poor man cried, and the Lord heard him and saved him out of his troubles. Is this talking about an economically poor man? The Lord heard him. Again, we have to compare scripture with scripture, and I want to quote my references after disappearing here. I want to quote Matthew Henry when he's talking about Matthew 5 verse 3, which talks about the poor in spirit. It talks about the God hears the poor and the needy, but is he talking about people who live in the street? Now, obviously, you don't need to be wealthy to come into the kingdom of God, at least earthly, with earthly means, etc. But let's look at what... Is that the only way to understand this? And it's a very carnal interpretation of that and completely devoid of what the rest of Scripture says. For example, in the Beatitudes, when Jesus is preaching, it says, "Blessed are the poor in spirit." It's a spiritual poverty. It's a spiritual need. It's a spiritual crying out to God. That's the way God hears them. How do they do that? Because they've been regenerated by the Spirit of God. They were dead in trespasses and sins, and they, by faith, have laid hold upon the promises of God, that He is the true Messiah, and He paid the sin debt of all those who would ever believe. He lived the perfect life that way. His positive righteousness, that He fulfilled the law during His life, death, and burial, resurrection, that is imputed, attributed to their account. Matthew Henry says about the poor in spirit are happy, verse 3, there is a poor spiritness that so far from making man blessed, that is a sin and a snare, cowardice and base fear and a willing subjection to the lust of men. But this poverty, and this is the key point, of spirit is a gracious disposition of soul, a a gracious disposition. You're grateful. You realize how spiritually bankrupt you are without God. Okay, continuing with Matthew Henry's quote, by which we are emptied of self in order that our being filled with Christ. To be poor in spirit is, number one, to be contentedly poor, willing to be emptied of worldly wealth if God orders that it be our lot, to bring our mind to our condition when it is a low condition. It means to be emptied of self and to have a gracious disposition. It does not talk necessarily about economic poverty, that you have to be poor in order for God to help, for God to hear you. That is not what the psalmist talks about. That is not what Job talks about when he mentions that. So this is a completely carnal understanding, again, from Rome. Okay, let's return to this video.
I think it comes from the teachings of Jesus. Jesus knew that way back, and it's something that we as humans have not grasped. Some of us can, and others can't. For whatever reason, we don't listen to the teachings from way back. I mean, isn't that what he came to teach us, and we don't listen to grasped?
Just want to... This is Sister Mary Campos, RSM, Cristo Rey High School. Again, it's in California, Northern California, Sacramento, California, just to have references. But I'm going to try and track down the rest of this video. But this is Catholic social teaching, and I've not seen many alterations of that. They would deny it's got anything to do with fascism, but that is essentially what the core doctrine of fascism is, a controlled economy.
Some of us can, and others can't, for whatever reason.
I'm going to skip on a little bit.
But we
from a scripture that says the Lord hears the cry of the poor. It's also the line of a popular...
He talks about the Lord hears the cry of the poor. Father James Martin, this is a Jesuit who writes for American magazine, James Martin.
Him. And I always wondered, well, why is that? That seemed a little favoritism, it seemed to me. It seemed like God was playing favorites. And I always wondered, why is God close to the poor? And when I was in Nairobi, I found an answer. God is close to the poor because the poor have less between them and God.
Out of the gospel message comes the idea of social justice. It is concerned with equal justice.
Notice how it says it's out of the gospel message. Pope Francis talks very similar. This is what the social gospel is. This is what it is. Doing good works, good deeds in the community. They'll say by the grace of God, but this is something that you maintain your justification. You maintain good works post salvation works almost. But they say out of the gospel, this is the social gospel, this is social justice, and this is invading so-called evangelical seminaries.
Justice, not just in the courts, but in all aspects of society. In a word, it's about fairness. The term social justice was coined by the Jesuit Luigi Taparelli in the 1840s, based on the teachings of Thomas Aquinas. At the height of the Industrial Revolution in 1891, when Catholic workers were leaning toward the ideas of Marx and socialism to find their dignity and voice, Pope Leo XIII, who studied under Taparelli, published a letter to the whole church on the topics of capital and labor. He called it Rerum Novarum, in English, of new things. In it, he rejected the popular ideas of both socialism and capitalism while defending labor unions and private property. He stated that society needed to be based on cooperation and not class conflict and unfair competition. The Pope taught that the role of the state is to promote social justice through the protection of basic human rights.
See, the role of the state is to protect human rights. And what are those human rights? It's basically everything from healthcare, this, that, and the other. So that the state always has to intervene. Calling for government intervention. More and more. And you need a bigger government to do that. That is not free market capitalism. That is not what the Protestant capitalist countries before, that's where, you know, the term the Protestant work ethic was coined.
He said, "The economy must serve people, not the other way around. People are more important than things. Labor is more important than capital." For over 100 years since Rerum Novarum, succeeding popes have addressed the issues put forward in this document.
So it's in that time Leo decides, and this is revolutionary, I'm going to write an encyclical on a social issue. Not a churchy issue, not about...
This is another Jesuit, Tom Weston, who's a retreat director at Oakland, California.
This or that, or, but something that's going on in our world, and he calls it Rerum Novarum. There's a new order of things happening, and it's industrialization. It's the factories. It's modernization.
Well, I think it was revolutionary in the sense that it was, I believe anyway, historically, the first time that a pope spoke out in terms of a formal document in favor of the laborer.
This is Bishop Carlos Silva, another Jesuit, retired bishop of Yakima. Not sure what states starts with W and A. I'm actually Irish, so forgive me.
Of the laborers, and connected very much with the gospel. So, and that...
Notice how it says it's connected with the gospel. These things are connected. Out of the gospel comes this idea of social justice, social gospel.
Is really the founding document of everything that's come since then. John Paul II certainly followed through with that in many of his encyclicals that touched on social issues as well. But I think Leo XIII opened the door to this, involvement, so that the church sees that as part of what it means to be church, is this is the kind of thing we need to be doing.
And with Pius IX, who was pope for a very long time, a very long, angry, discouraging time, anything that was new was simply wrong. Leo's in that atmosphere too, but Leo does, he's going to talk about contemporary times to contemporary people.
Rerum Novarum, I probably reference that quite a bit because it speaks of the dignity and rights of the human person. And the human person is somebody who works, right? And I love this idea that when we work, we are co-creators with God. When I teach...
Now, there's a lot of anti-biblical ideas that go on. And you can... I'll put the video in the description of the show. Ultimately, it sounds wonderful. It talks about restoring dignity and all this kind of thing. But it amounts to collectivism. Collectivism, there's different forms of collectivism. And Rome's ideas from Rerum Novarum, which are still being used and been referenced by many popes since the encyclical was written in 1891. It is not pure Marxism, because it's kind of more or less speaks out against that. And that's why I don't say Pope Francis, for example, is a Marxist. But his ideas are very much similar to liberation theology. There's various ways of reading. You see, it depends on the need of the people. And if you read Aquinas at times, it's virtuous and it is just and right to kill a tyrant if the need of the society is... so dictates that. And how do you define that? Well, it's according to the dictates of the teaching in the Church of Rome. Again, it's always going to be surrounded in flowery language, but you see how many we just play there. There was a number of Jesuits speaking on this. Leo XIII was trained under Luigi Taparelli, according to Roman Catholic sources themselves. And this is... these are ideas that are coming into the true church, destroying true churches, that we must be out there feeding the poor, otherwise they're not going to possibly listen to our gospel message. That is when we're closest to God and God is at first at work. We just feed them first and then later on. We must do acts of justice. Timothy Keller is very, very similar with that kind of thing. And Lord willing, I'll get a chance to do a show on Timothy Keller in the near future. I pray that this has been somewhat of a help to people. If people got questions on this, email me at mcgittlefilms@gmail.com. If you have any suggestions, different areas, and you might think, Paul, maybe if you cover this area a bit more detail, or if you even have people who might be really, really strong in this area. Now, this is an area that's not really well known. I've found very few people to write about this. For example, there's quite a good radio broadcast that's on Sermon Audio talking about Thomas Aquinas that's done by Richard Bennett, who is a former Roman Catholic priest who's got a great ministry in the United States called the Berean Beacon. And he's based in Texas at the moment. And he has spoken about Thomas Aquinas. He has spoken about some of these issues. So if you want to research this further, I would go to some of the things like that. But if you can recommend other things, because I'm trying to gather anything I can get my hands on. I've been studying this for a number of years, but I really want to get... There's not many people who are covering this issue, sadly. And there's a lot of things on the Trinity Foundation website. There's a lot of lectures on that website done by John W. Robbins. I believe Gordon H. Clark, who passed away some 20 years ago, he's well known in apologetics, presuppositional apologetic circles. He has talked some on these issues, but John W. Robbins has spoken a lot about economics and things like this. This may be quite difficult for certain people who don't spend a lot of time studying economic theory and things like that. But if we can grasp this one thing, the Bible speaks about private property. Thou shalt not steal. Thou shalt not covet. That, and this principle flourished, spread throughout Europe. And this, I don't want to make this the main central thing. It wasn't that the Protestant Reformation was about spreading the ideas of private property. No, it was the true gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ changing people's hearts. And then their lives followed and changed and followed the Word of God. And what the Reformers and the Puritans did afterwards, they took the Word of God and applied it to all areas of life, not just some areas, not just the soteriology, making sure you're a Calvinist or Reformed, but that all areas of life, the worship of God, is it ordained in the Word of God? Or is it a stench before the living God? These are the questions we need to ask. And when we're dealing with what was the proper role of state, etc., let us dig into Scripture, ask these questions. And that way, we're not destroyed for lack of knowledge. We do not retreat to the enemy, allowing them ground, which the Word of God says, that we should hold every thought captive, pulling down strongholds raised against the knowledge of the truth. And those strongholds, those logismos in Greek, these ideas, these fortifications that have been raised against the knowledge of the truth. I pray this has been a blessing to many of you. Again, email any questions at mcgittlefilms@gmail.com. This has been Paul Flynn. Talk to you next week.